I don't think we've got the full extent of what's actually happened to Mitch.
I know that somewhere in a school, somewhere in Victoria, there'll be a child who is being physically restrained.
Now they're in primary school, you know, what are they meant to do?
I've had so much stuff done to me.
In an ideal world, policies changed. CCTVs put in the classrooms.
I just don't understand why abuse is going unchecked in our system. Okay, sitting. He used to love school, and suddenly he didn't want to go. In fact, he was scared, and he would shake his head and not want to get changed in the morning to go down to the car to be taken to the school.
6-year-old Michael, not his real name, no longer leaves the house to go to school. For over a year, he's been homeschooled by his parents.
It's a terrible position to be in. It's financially hard for us to do this as well. We have to fund everything ourselves, and that's a struggle.
Their struggle began in 2012 when they started noticing a change in their son's behaviour.
He would come back and he'd be sweating and stressed, and he would just close off. And when we then gave him a 2-week break from the school, he was really settled. And then he'd go back and something would be going on there that would be upsetting him. But he doesn't have a voice to tell us.
Michael has autism and is largely non-verbal. He spent 18 months in a special class at a nearby public school in the New South Wales Hunter region. That ended suddenly in 2013.
I remember getting ready for school, and I remember taking him in, and then he came back and we changed him, and we saw these two bruises. We're kind of going, what caused that?
In September that year, Michael came home from school with a bruise on his arm.
We turned to each other and said, did you see this morning? No. And he has to raise his arms to get his top on and off. So we're going, where did this come from? And we just went, it was adult. It was adult finger marks received from school.
David believes his son was physically abused by a staff member at Katara South Public School and that it wasn't an isolated incident.
There's been a whole build-up of events happening at his school. We noticed bruising on him, but we just assumed it was probably a child. You don't think that it would be an adult.
He says days before his son came home with bruising, his wife witnessed an incident in the playground involving another non-verbal child.
So it was just here that basically the incident happened, with the child being, the balls being separated, then the teacher's aide screaming at the child, grabbing him, dragging him over by his arm, then forcing him to the ground, and then twisting his arm as he screams in pain.
The school looked into the incidents in 2013 and found no misconduct had occurred. Those findings were reviewed by the New South Wales Education Department in 2015. The department declined to be interviewed, but in a statement told the feed it was satisfied with the way the school handled the matter and that there was no evidence the incidents had occurred in the alleged manner. This essentially meant David's case was closed. But David says during the initial inquiry, his family's testimony was never sought.
It was not possible to clearly establish the cause of the bruising to our child's arm. Therefore, they will not take any further action. Why? That's what we've been asking ever since, is, well, what was investigated? Because we weren't contacted.
I didn't learn about the sorts of abusive practices that were happening to kids until maybe about 4 years ago. And then the more you uncover and the more you speak about it, the more people approach you. And I guess I've now realised that it's fairly endemic throughout Australia.
It's a bright Tuesday afternoon in Bendigo, Victoria, but 13-year-old Mitchell isn't at school.
Was at the school I was previously at, I got called a retard, stupid, by students and also my friends. So yeah, sort of, a lot of kids would feel like they don't want to go to school.
Mitchell was diagnosed with autism at age 7. Over the years came more diagnoses.
So now I've got ODD, full dyslexia, on the verge of being diagnosed with schizophrenia. It's a big, big thing for him to deal with every day.
Life is challenging for Mitchell, but school is even more so.
In one word, horrific. That wouldn't be an understatement. He's had 6 primary schools, teachers that have been amazing, and we've had teachers that I class as teachers from hell.
Michelle believes her son was physically abused by staff at 2 separate primary schools in Western Victoria over a period of 5 years beginning in 2011.
The things that I know about are him being tied to a chair, being locked in offices. I know that he's been grabbed by the back of his neck by a teacher and pulled to the ground because they thought he was going to run. I got told by parents a lot, but on occasions I've gone to pick him up and he's been locked in rooms. He had marks on his wrist and his ankles, but no one could explain to me why. Due to the fact that we had no proof and it was all hearsay from other parents or myself, it was your word against theirs, so not even a slap on the wrist.
But Michelle says it's left her son emotionally damaged.
After the first couple of schools, Mitch had a serious relapse. He became suicidal due to bad teachers. I've seen the point where he is so broken that he feels like there's nowhere else to go. And some days it's hard. He's standing there begging you to end his life because he thinks it would be so much better. People just don't get it.
With me, I rather not talk about it. I just, you know, close it up. And over time, I forget about it.
The impact is extremely serious. Some of these children have been subjected to restraint and seclusion multiple times before they've even left primary school. Some of my clients are so traumatised by that they cannot attend school anymore.
So the longer that he's with me 24/7, the worse the anxiety separation gets from me.
Yeah, I feel like I have too much time with Mum, because with me, when I get angry, I need to retreat to somewhere. When you're in the caravan, you really can't.
Mitchell's conditions mean he's prone to difficult and at times violent behaviour. So violent that he and his mother were forced to leave their family home following one of Mitchell's outbursts. For the last 8 weeks, they've been living in a caravan park.
It's not even an option to not do this for him. It's not an option to just say, well, okay, I can't do this anymore and sorry, you're on your own. He's 13. He's a child who needs his parent.
Michelle has found herself in a desperate situation. She's sought to secure a place for Mitchell at a local special school that he's keen to attend. The school requires an IQ of between 50 and 70. Mitchell's is only just higher.
There's letters from not only his psychiatrist, but DHS, CAMS, myself, other people that were involved with Mitchell, all stipulating that it would be the best environment for him to be at.
Michelle says despite countless recommendations, officials from the education department have told her it's unlikely he'll get in. Thus far, there's been no formal application made. There are other special schools in the area, one of which the feed can reveal is being accused of mistreating its students.
People get into teaching, in my belief, because they have an empathy for children. That's why I got into being a primary school teacher. You like kids and you think you're going to get this wonderful opportunity to nurture. And I guess primarily you do, but it's all changing. And now the classroom is more of a war ground.
These days, Philip Carroll's workplace is a child for his own. It's a far cry from his old job at Bendigo Special Developmental School, where he worked as a teacher for 5 years before his employment was terminated in 2011.
How are you, Pat?
During my time at the school, we had cages that were put into the classrooms. I had one in my year in 2009. It was probably 4 feet by 4 feet and maybe 4 or 5 feet high. This one student was in there for a lot of the time because if he was allowed to let loose running around, he'd be vomiting on other children or biting other children.
Philip alleges between 2006 and 2011, abuse at the school was commonplace, particularly the use of painful points on the body.
I've seen these pressure points. So what we were taught to do was to put our fingers just in behind the ears there, and there's a pressure point where you just lift them up. And if they fight you, it hurts like hell. So they lift up to, you know, relieve the pain, and you can just pick them up. Those autistic kids often like the chasey game, you know, they run away. So we were taught to, for example, to put the arm of a child up the back, like so, and then push on the shoulder blade. And that way you could just walk the child back to class. Regardless of the size of the child, you could just bring them in from anywhere in the school like that and take them back to class.
Those allegations are unfounded. You know, they're unfounded. Our school is a very good school. It's a very active school. We have lots of community input. I'm not worried by you coming. I'm glad you're here.
Hello, Rep
team.
Hello.
Bendigo SDS has 75 staff that cater to 132 students with a range of intellectual and physical disabilities.
We have hands-on and we're on the ground and we know what's happening in our school. The atmosphere, the caring community that we have, or special schools have, that's probably what brings you to work every day.
So this is our therapy room.
Julia Hommelhoff has been the principal here for 6 years.
I'm just going to run through some of those allegations. The existence of cages at the school.
You've been through our school? We don't have cages at our school.
Pre-existing cages from before he started, cages in classrooms, 4 foot by 4 foot sort of structures.
We don't have cages in our school. We have students in our school that we cater for and cater for really well.
Philip was fired from Bendigo SDS in 2011. According to the Victorian Department of Education, he was found to have undertaken a series of physical actions against students that were completely inappropriate, including the inappropriate use of restraint. There was an internal appeal, but his termination was upheld.
Yeah, I restrained students. It was written into their behaviour management plans.
He says the practices he was fired for were condoned.
It became very clear that the things that I basically lost my job for, like I always knew they were commonplace, but they were commonplace, they're everywhere. Like at the time it's your work and you think you're doing the right thing, whatever.
One of the other kind of allegations put forward by Phil was the use of pressure points here at the school, the pressing of certain places on the body to...
We don't use pressure points. We don't train our staff in pressure points. Our staff work really hard. They're a very dedicated staff. We do not use pressure points. That's unfounded.
There's never been an incident that in your time here where you've heard of that happening?
No. Unfounded.
During the filming of this story, the feed was contacted by the parents of a child currently enrolled at Bendigo SDS. They wish to remain anonymous, but in a statement they say they believe a staff member used pressure points on their son in October of last year, and that apart from the staff member in question and their non-verbal child, there was only one other witness.
It came to home time and we met the child's mother. She asked, how was my child's day? And I didn't really respond. She looked at me and I looked at her, and yeah, she told me later on, after I informed her what happened, that yeah, she knew something wasn't right.
Dennis Kelly was the third person in that room. He was working as casual support staff at the school in October last year.
Myself and the other worker went to the gymnasium. We took two students with us. They had a good time, they completed their session. One student put their shoes on and gone back to class, and the other student assumed a position on the floor, lying down flat, and just didn't want to move.
Dennis says what happened next shocked him.
The other ES worker with me said, Dennis, do you know how to use pressure points? I stopped and said, no, I don't know what you mean. She proceeded to tell me, we use pressure points on this child when he won't get up like this, holding her thumbs up like that. She said, just apply firm pressure under the armpits and he'll basically get up and moved back to class. I definitely feel that he felt pain. And she said, yeah, we use this when we have to, and, you know, it works with good effect.
He says the following week he reported what he'd seen to the principal.
At the time, she seemed quite shocked, reassured me that she would fully investigate and talk to the staff member involved.
When that complaint came in October of last year, I believe it was, what sort of steps did you take to act on it?
It doesn't matter what complaint comes through, we have our complaints procedure. I would follow that thoroughly.
And what is that?
Investigate that.
And what is that?
Whatever comes forth, you investigate. And I would follow our complaints procedure to do that.
But in relation to that specific incident which happened?
Any incident that comes forward.
But I'm asking you in relation to that specific incident, what sort of...
And I'm saying to you, any incident that comes forward, I would thoroughly investigate it.
Why are you unable to tell me the ways in which you investigated it?
Because I'm not going to discuss individual cases.
According to emails, Julie says she followed up with the staff member involved.
I remain satisfied that your allegations regarding the use of pressure points by the staff member are unfounded. How dare you? How dare you say I've created this story? It feels like a smear campaign at the moment where I've fabricated the entire story.
And have you?
Oh, definitely not. No. It's quite offensive when people do say that, you know, what you've stated isn't true. Because it was for no benefit of myself. The staff could be perpetrating these types of procedures because the child is non-verbal. He's not going to write down an account of what happened. He's not going to appear in court and say, this person did that. He has no voice. So if I can't be his voice, who can?
The feed understands the staff member still works at Bendigo SDS.
Teachers are damned if they do or damned if they don't. If they restrain the child, they're doing it most likely with the intention of stopping them from hurting themselves or harming others, right? That was why I did it. If they don't restrain the child, then the child is likely to harm someone else, and you're going to have a parent saying, well, why did my child get headbutted, or where are these bite marks from, or...
So what do you do?
Yes, that's the problem.
According to the Victorian Education and Training Reform Regulations, restraining a student is legal. Regulation 15 states a member of the staff of a government school may take any reasonable action that is immediately required to restrain a student of the school from acts or behaviour dangerous to the member of staff, the student, or any other person.
This is the regulation that is commonly quoted by any regional director or deputy secretary to defend any type of restraint and seclusion against a child with a disability. And as you can see, it's one sentence, no definitions. It's the broadest sort of regulation you could possibly have.
The department says there are guidelines around the use of restraint, which should only be employed when there's an immediate danger to a person's safety.
Not too bad.
For me, I felt like there was kind of no other options but to find out what had actually happened to my son.
In terms of Rebecca's case, while we chose to take that on, we're obviously very concerned for Tristan, the young boy, the subject of the allegations.
And here's Mookie there. And as Thor's brother, he's just a god of mischief. He was also a trickster.
Tristan, like any other 12-year-old boy, is talkative.
And here comes Spider-Man.
Loves action figurines and playing video games.
And if you get the most KOs, wins.
Unlike other boys his age, he's the subject of a discrimination case against the Victorian Education Department that's set to go before the federal court.
Speaking to lawyers to see what options I had, more just to find out how far this had actually gone, because I didn't really have an idea on until getting all the freedom of information, and even that, I believe I haven't got all of it. So I think there's a lot more that I don't know.
The case stems from an incident in 2012 when Rebecca went to pick Tristan up from school in Melbourne and ran into a staff member.
And I was standing in the hall and she came back with his school bag and she'd opened up this door, which I never even knew this room existed, unlocked the door. It was pitch black. It was no bigger than a disabled toilet. I found the light switch and I found Tristan laying on a tiled floor, crying, bawling his eyes out. He just looked terrified.
Documents obtained by Rebecca under Freedom of Information showed Tristan was regularly placed in a timeout room, which she believes was the room she saw. On some occasions, he'd be sent there up to 3 times a day. The schools denied the existence of such a room, but their actions could be found to be in breach of the Federal Discrimination Act. The department says it's defending the matter and is unable to comment.
I do think that in terms of the legislation we're working with, it really does represent a new and emerging area of law. And we do believe in Rebecca's case, and I'm hopeful that we can continue to press the envelope in terms of the disability compensation.
Have you sort of seen cases like this before?
All the confidentiality stuff.
Since 2000, the Victorian Education Department says it's settled 4 cases where allegations of restraint were made. They would not disclose the amount of compensation paid to parents. Often with cases settled outside of court, parents are required to sign confidentiality agreements, meaning they can't openly discuss what happened to their child. Rebecca's taking on the state in the hope that things will change, and for her, they might, but perhaps not for others.
If the department wishes to, it can stop a case proceeding by settling it. That's okay for an individual, but what happens is that the system is the same. So we have the same lack of resources, the same lack of training, the same refusal to prohibit the restrictive practices.
Rebecca is somewhat more optimistic.
Excited. That's probably not nice to say excited, but excited in the prospect of this never happening to my son again. Maybe any other kid, excited that there could be change or they're actually going to listen.
The outcome of Tristan's case will be of particular interest to David and Michelle, both of whom say they're prepared to take their cases further.
This whole abuse situation that we've observed and we suspect has been happening has just told us that our kids, all our kids, are not safe until the DEC starts to recognise abuse is happening and it needs to be dealt with, and dealt with firmly. Let's get up!
My hopes and dreams are that he can live a relatively good life, have a family of his own his own home, and it can be done. But it's whether the environment is right.
I want to finish year 12, so if when I do, and if I ever see those teachers again, I will say to them, to their face, I did it. I actually did it. Not many people believe I can do that. I will get there. It may be a long road, but I will eventually get there.